did that all the time. Honey, if life had to slow down for you, I don't know what you would do, and there is truth to that. When I'm home, I love being home. In fact, after traveling the United States of America and the world for 32 years, home is a very special place for me, and I love being there as much as I can. But after being there for a few days, I get a little antsy. I want to get back out on the road and serving the King, and so it's been a wonderful day for me. Hope it has for you as well. By the way, I love the song that our sister sang. There is a place called grace. Isn't that a great truth? A great truth, a place we can flee to. Not only God's saving grace, but you know, God gives us living grace. Titus 2 verses 11 and 12, or 10 and 11 actually say this, or 11 and 12, I'll get it right in a minute. It says, "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us," that His grace teaches us something. What does grace teach us? Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Boy, God's grace doesn't just save us, it teaches us how to live life down here on earth. And so I love that song. Absolutely beautifully, beautifully done. And the congregation, you have sung well tonight as well. And so it is a blessing and a delight to be able to be here. Now, because I met some of my friends, and it's not your fault, guys, please, I'm not blaming it on you, but when I got out of my car tonight, I met some friends from another part of West Virginia. And they just kind of follow me around, track me down when I'm anywhere close. And that's great. I love it. I love seeing their smiling faces. But I was going to have that sign-up list tonight down on the front here at the communion table for the National Bible Reading Marathon, which comes up next May, just to see if anybody from Daniel's Missionary Baptist Church would like to come and read the scriptures from the West Plaza of the United States Capitol. But I got to talking to them, and because my memory is outstanding but incredibly short now at 57 years of age, I forgot to grab that out of my car. And again, that is not their fault. That was my fault. But I will have that tomorrow night right here on the communion table. And so if you're interested in knowing more about coming the first week of May, Sunday before the Thursday of the National Day of Prayer. Thursday, by the way, a National Day of Prayer has been that way since 1952. We have had a National Day of Prayer since 1952. But from 1952 to 1988, the day we commemorated the National Day of Prayer kind of bounced around on the calendar. It would move from month to month. Never knew exactly when it was going to be. That was determined by the leadership of the National Day of Prayer organization. But in 1988, Ronald Wilson Reagan, our 40th president, said we need to have a set day every year that we commemorate the National Day of Prayer so it doesn't slip up on us, so we have it, you know, known in our minds. It's always going to be this day. So enacted by Congress, signed into law by President Reagan, the first Thursday in May became that day. And so since 1988, first Thursday of May has been the time when we acknowledge as a nation to the Lord, "Lord, we need you." Now please understand, all the way out through our 240-year history, we have had periodic days of prayer. Our presidents have initiated those, but an official day we commemorate annually did not start until 52, and it wasn't the first Thursday of May until 1988. And so it's always that week, and so the Sunday prior to that first Thursday in May, we begin reading the Bible from the West Plaza of the United States Capitol for 90 hours, nonstop, day and night, rain or shine. You say, "Preacher, people are there at 3 in the morning reading the Bible." Yes, they are, and loving every minute of it. In fact, last week I was in Indiana. There's a huge group that now comes from around Indianapolis, Indiana, that reads the Bible. And one of the gentlemen told me, he said, "Dave, I know a lot of people don't want that 2 in the morning till 7 o'clock in the morning time slot." He said, "Man, we sign up for those," because he said there's still people walking around the Capitol and there's all kinds of things going on even in those early morning hours. And he said, "You can just read and just project your voice and the Word of God is heard down across the National Mall from the West Plaza. It's an awesome, awesome thing." And so if you have an interest in coming and being a part of that, you let me know and the sign-up list will be down there. And by the way, if you put your name on the list, that doesn't mean we're going to come looking for you if you don't show up, all right? It doesn't mean you're signing your life away or anything like that. It just means you're interested, seriously interested. And then I can give your information to a lady named Terry Hall, who is the one who gets everybody signed up, and I will forward to you via your email address or snail mail address, whichever you happen to have. Email is preferable. But whichever you have, I will send you the information for Terry. You can contact her if you know you're going to come. And you can say, "I'd like to read this day, this time." And if those slots are still available, then you can read. If they're not available, she'll tell you what is available. and then you can get signed up for one of those slots that are left. And by the way, you can read 5 minutes. You can choose to read 5 hours if you want to. You say, "Preacher, really? 5 hours?" Yes, I signed up for a three-hour slot several years ago, took people with me, and we just alternated back and forth for 3 hours, and it was an awesome thing. So if you have an interest in that, let me know. And again, the sign-up sheet. I'm saying this over and over so that I will remember. You understand what I'm doing, all right? I'm just repeating it for myself, not for you. But the sign-up list will be down there tomorrow night, and you can sign up, and you can come and experience one of the greatest, most life-changing weeks you will ever spend anywhere in our nation's capital. And by the way, a lot of things to do and a lot of things to see in D.C., during the time that you're not reading. And if you want to sign up for multiple times, you can do that as well. Psalm 100 tonight, if you would, please. Psalm 100. Can I say something to you? I just want to say it because it's in my heart. I love you, folk. Hope you know that. I wish I had an arm long enough on the right-hand side, long enough on the left-hand side to go down that aisle and down that aisle and just meet at the back and kind of hug all of you and let you know how much I love and appreciate this church. Never been here until last year. Just knew your pastor and have known him for a long time and love him and his family and respect him greatly. And so I knew if he was here, I knew this had to be a great church or you wouldn't have called him. But it's a blessing to be able to be here, and I'm looking forward to what God's going to do tonight and the remaining two nights. And this week, as far as revival, will be over. It doesn't seem possible, but friends, just try to get everything you can. I'm trying to do the same thing. As God speaks to our heart, respond to Him. Don't miss a single thing that God has for us during these days. And then we'll be the better. The church will be the better. Our homes will be the better. Our community will be the better for all of it. And our nation will be the better for it as well. And by the way, my heart is overflowing tonight. This afternoon I found out some things, and I'm not at liberty to share any of it with you. I'm bursting at the seams too, but I cannot. But I want you to know, friends, keep your head up in the air. There's good things going on in the United States of America. Can I hear an amen right there? Oh, I'm not seeing it in the news. Of course, they're not going to show you on the news. They're not going to tell you good stuff in the news because they want ratings. And, you know, typically they get high ratings from bad news and controversy and all kinds of negative things. But I want you to know God is about good news. Are you with me? And there's good things going on all across our nation. And again, maybe before the week's out, if I get permission to do so, I'll be able to share a little with you about what I'm talking about. If not, just trust me, it's good stuff. And I'm excited about where we are and what God's doing. In the midst of incredibly dark days, light is still shining brightly. Psalm 100, hope you found it. 2 weeks ago, I was in a place for the probably 20th time, I guess I've been in that place. It's called Bethel Colony of Mercy. It is a Christian drug and alcohol rehab facility located in Lenoir, North Carolina, which is about 25 minutes from where my wife and I's home sits. Every year they have what's called their annual Bible conference, and at 9 o'clock in the morning, 7 o'clock at night, they have two services a day, and it's been my privilege to be able to preach there multiple times down through the last 26 years. And awesome place. There are guys there from literally all over the world. You'll have guys that come there that used to work at the front office of the National Football League, the NFL, but their cocaine addiction cost them everything. There was a gentleman that I met there who had been a marine biologist at the University of South Carolina, highly intelligent gentleman, but he got hooked on crack cocaine and he lost everything. Other guys, very prominent, I mean very wealthy, very successful men, but their alcohol addiction or maybe a pornography addiction cost them everything. And they hit rock bottom and they end up at Bethel Colony of Mercy. Some of them are there because they've committed crimes. And in lieu of going to jail immediately, they're sent to Bethel Colony of Mercy as a last-ditch effort to help rescue them. And that place is a place where God meets with men. And I love it there. We had 18 men saved while we were there. And there's only 82 men in the program at any one time. And 18 of them came to know Christ as Savior. It's an amazing place. Now, the reason I'm telling you all that is this. First time I was ever there, I was so impressed by what I saw that I asked the director in those days, Brother Paul Ritchie, I said, "Brother Paul, what is the kind of material you give to the men and use with them?" I'm talking about printed material. He said, "Well, we give them a lot of stuff." I said, "Well, I don't want to add to your workload or to your secretary's workload, but I would love to have a copy of everything you use with the men." Well, the next night, he handed me a file folder about that thick, and it was laid out in chronological order, the order in which they give the stuff to the men. And that night I went home and I thumbed through all of it. And Pastor, I'm going to tell you, it was amazing stuff. It took me several hours to do that. But when I finally got to the last sheet, the last piece of printed information they give to the men before they graduate after 65 days in that program, across the top of the sheet it said this: the five Bethel principles. Parentheses, the key to keeping your victory. In other words, whenever you graduate from this Christian drug and alcohol rehab facility, there are five things you must understand that are the key to keeping your victory. They call them the five Bethel principles. Now, I want to mention them to you. And by the way, you may want to write these down. These are not just good for somebody addicted to a substance. These are great for us. By the way, Pastor, I have reaped tremendous benefit, as you're going to see in just a minute, from the five Bethel principles. Here they are. Number one, live by the Scriptures. Live by the Scriptures. By the way, that's not just good advice for the cocaine addict. That's good advice for the member of Daniel's Missionary Baptist Church. What they tell them there is this: men, when you get out of here, what you're going to have to do is make a commitment to live by the Word of God. Your life has got to be ordered by the Scriptures. Can I hear an amen right there? Principle number one, live by the Scriptures. Number two, guard and control your thought life. Guard and control your thought life. Many times I've heard Brother Richie and now the new director, Brother Paul Pruitt, I've heard him say to the men this: guys, you will win or lose the battle in your life because it will be fought and ultimately won between your ears. That is, before you ever, young people, very important, before you ever, mom and dad, very important, before you ever act out any sinful act or behavior, you will have lived that act many, many times between your ears in the recesses of your mind. Are you with me? So it's vitally important, if we're going to be victorious in our life, we've got to guard and control our thought life. Number one, live by the Scriptures. Number two, guard and control your thought life. Number three, submit to discipline. Submit to discipline. By the way, I've heard Brother Richie say this to those men: guys, the reason you're here is because up to this point, he said, I love you enough to tell you, up to this point in your life, you have lived a very undisciplined life. Maybe you didn't have a mom or a dad that tried to instill discipline into you. Maybe you never joined the military, or maybe you never went to a school that had teachers that tried to instill in you discipline. And America is cursed like we've never been cursed before with the most undisciplined culture I've ever seen in my life. Anybody know what I'm talking about? So, men, if you're going to be a success, you've got to submit to discipline. Only he's talking about spiritual discipline. And, Pastor, I've heard Brother Richie say this: guys, when you get out of here, you need to find yourself a church that believes and preaches the Bible. Can I hear an amen right there? You need to submit yourself to that church and to the authority of that pastor, and you need to learn to submit to discipline because you are not the most important cause in your life. Can I hear an amen? By the way, I'm not the most important cause either. There's a cause bigger than me and you, and it's the cause of Jesus Christ. If you're going to be a success, you've got to submit to discipline. Preach, it's great for us, isn't it? Live by the Scriptures, guard and control your thought life, submit to discipline. Number four, cultivate right relationships. Cultivate right relationships. Guys, I cannot tell you how many times I've been at Bethel. 2 years later, I'm back. Some of the men that were there when I was there 2 years prior are now back in the program. And I ask them this: how come are you back? You were here last time. I saw you last time I was here. And every time they'll say this: preacher, when I got out 2 years ago, I went back to the same friends that got me in trouble, that necessitated me having to come to Bethel. And I've learned this. I've heard every one of them say, I've learned this. I can't go back to my old friends when Jesus has changed my life. Well, the principle, if they'd have lived it out, was right there, the key to keeping your victory. You have got to not only live by the Scriptures, guard and control your thought life, submit to discipline, you've got to cultivate right relationships. Mom and dad, young people, the friendships we choose will make us or break us. So this is a critical principle. Now, those folks, first four, are pretty easy to understand. However, the fifth one on the list, I'm going to be honest with you, I struggled with it when I read it. In fact, I struggled so much, I went to Brother Richie the next night and I said, Brother Richie, help me understand something. The first four of these principles that are the key to keeping your victory, I can understand every one of them. Man, that's vitally important. I understand them. But the fifth one, to me, just to me, looking at it here as an outsider, I would never put number five on the list because, to me, in my thinking, I don't think that ranks nearly as high on the list of importance as the first four. In fact, I probably would not even include it on a list of five things. There are other things, in my opinion, I would put number five, but not this. Why did you choose that? And Pastor Brother Richie looked at me, and he's a little short, skinny, scrawny guy. But when he says jump, those men ask how high, because he's got God's power in his life. He started preaching me a sermon going all the way through the Bible, quoting verse after verse that has to deal with point number five. By the time he was done, I said, okay, I get it. I understand. And by the way, I agree with you. Number five is a vitally important thing to keeping your victory in the Christian life. You say, well, Brother Dave, what is it? Here it is. Hope you'll write it down. Learn to praise God daily. Learn to praise God daily. I'm going to repeat it a third time. Learn to praise God daily. You say, preacher, is that really that important? I didn't think it was. I've learned since it is. You say, preacher, why is it that important? Now, what I want to do very, very quickly is take you on a very rapid journey through the scriptures very quickly. I want you to see three simple things tonight. By the way, I implore you to write them down. Someone said to me years ago, if you mark your Bible, you'll be marked by your Bible. I believe that to be true. And Pastor, I'm not trying to impress anybody, but I want you to see what I do. My wife said, honey, I can't read any of that. What I do is I mark my Bible. I write things, I highlight things, and I write things in the margin. And she said, I can't read any of it. And I said, well, you're not the one that has to be able to read it. I'm the only one that has to be able to read it. And by the way, ma'am, if you'll hold my Bible from about right there, I can read it because my eyes have gotten worse and I've gotten farsighted, so I have to have it about 30 feet away, you know, to be able to read it. But the bottom line is this: if you mark your Bible, you'll be marked by your Bible. So I want to talk to you tonight from my heart about the most important thing perhaps we will discuss this week, and that is this concept of praising God. I want you to look at Psalm 100. Would you look at it, please? The scripture says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before His presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, He is God. It is He that hath made us and not we ourselves. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving and into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him and bless His name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting and His truth endureth to all generations. Now hold your finger there. Turn back to Psalm number 9. Psalm number 9, also talking about this concept of praise, Psalm 9 says this, and I want you to look at it with your own eyes. David is the human author of Psalm 9. By the way, he was the author of 77 of the 150 Psalms in the book of Psalms. In Psalm 9 verse 1, he says this, I will praise thee, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will, and I'd like you to do this, if you have a pen or pencil, if you have a marker, I'd like you to highlight, circle, underline, somehow make note of the next two words. I will show forth all thy marvelous works. I will show forth all thy marvelous works. Would you look up at me for a second? If you're taking notes, point number one, the principle of praise. What are we talking about when we talk about praising God? A lot of misconceptions. I come from North Carolina, and by the way, there are some people in North Carolina, they do crazy things. I don't know if any of you have ever been to an old-fashioned tent meeting, ever been to one of those, or old-fashioned camp meeting. Anybody know what a camp meeting is? Or ever been to one of those? In North Carolina, forgive me, you know what they'll do? There are people that'll get up, and they don't have chairs in those camp meetings, and you're smiling because you know where I'm going. By the way, I'm not going to illustrate it, okay? But anyway, they have pews that are anchored down, and they will literally get on the backs of the pews and run the backs of the pews. Now, is that praise? No, that's foolishness. That's dangerous, okay? I'm not talking about that, but what are we talking about when the Bible talks about praising God? It's tied up in those two words, show forth, in Psalm 9:1. I will show forth all thy marvelous works. You say, what does that mean? I'm a twin, okay? I'm a twin. My twin brother and I, growing up, only two of us in our family, we competed over everything. And I'm going to be honest with you, Pastor. My brother's about an inch and a half taller than I am. He's about 35 pounds lighter than I am. He's always been lighter than I am. He's a runner. He's been a basketball coach, coached a couple of state championships on the high school level in North Carolina. But he is an inch and a half taller, 35 pounds lighter, which means this. If he were here tonight, turned sideways, stuck his tongue out, he'd look like a zipper, wouldn't he? I mean, he is a thin guy, all right? So I didn't beat him at a lot of things growing up athletically, but if I did ever beat him, I promise you I did this. If it was with a stick in the ground, piece of chalk on chalkboard, pen or pencil on a piece of paper, if I beat my brother at anything, I would make a line like this, vertical line. If I beat my brother a second time, beside the first vertical line, I'd put another one. If I beat him a third time, a third line, fourth time, a fourth line, if I ever beat my brother five times at anything, which was very unusual, I would start in the upper left-hand corner of the first line. I'd draw a slash down through the succeeding three lines. You say, what were you doing, Brother Dave? I was keeping a running total of my victories over my brother. Are you with me? I was tallying up the score of my victories over my brother. You say, what does that have to do with praise? Look again at Psalm 9:1. I will praise thee, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will, here's the two operative words, I will show forth. Literally, the two words show forth in Hebrew mean to do this. I will keep a running total of God's goodness in my life. Let me ask you something, because we're getting close to it next month. Why is it that in the Church of Jesus Christ, we have pushed this thing of praise to something we do one time a year at Thanksgiving? And even then, preacher, we have a what's called a praise service. By the way, our church does a thing called praise and pie service. We have a praise service first, then we go over to the fellowship hall and we have pie. Boy, if that won't get you going, nothing will, okay? Praise and pie. That's good stuff. But why do we have praise services one time a year? And even one time a year, I've been in praise services. We're trying to get anybody to testify about God's goodness in their life. It's like trying to wrench a tooth out of their mouth with a pair of needle-nose pliers. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And if you have a dad like I did, you never told him you had a loose tooth? We didn't go to the dentist because we didn't have the money. He had a pair of needle-nose pliers. You tell dad you have your loose tooth, he's coming at you with them. And he'd say, you know, if you just let me get him right on there, I can twist and pull and shoot, that baby will pop right out. And he would. Testimonies coming from God's people ought not be like that. Are you with me? Why do we not praise God more freely? God has been good to us. Would you agree? The principle of praise means to tally up the score of God's goodness in our life. By the way, Pastor and I were praying before the service tonight, and he kind of got, I guess, a little hung up on it, and so did I, about God's salvation. Do you know we have enough to praise God for all day long just for salvation? God has been good to us. But look what we drove to the service tonight. Look what we're wearing tonight. Look at the homes we live in. Look at this beautiful church auditorium. Look at what God has given us in this country. Folks, we have enough to tally up the score and never end tallying up the score because God's been good to us. Now I want you to see two things about this principle of praise. Look back to Psalm 100. I've asked you to hold your finger there because we're going to come right there for a second. I want you to see two things about this principle of praise, this tallying up of the score. Number one, I want you to see that it is a command. Praise is a command. You say, preacher, man, with everything going on in the world, why are you talking about this? You're going to see in just a second. Look at verse 1 of Psalm 100. Praise is a command. Now, let me ask, anybody in here an English teacher or former English teacher? English teacher, former English teacher? My mom was an English teacher all of her adult life. Okay, no English or former English. Anybody in here read English or struggle to do it like I do? Okay, all right. My mom's in heaven. I hope I make her proud tonight. But she taught us something in the English language. She said, Dave, Dan, there is a thing in the English language called an imperative. You know what an imperative is? It is not a suggestion. Okay, let me give you one of my dad's imperatives growing up. Son, carry the garbage out. That was not a suggestion. Son, you know, when the ball game's over and if you kind of feel like it, you may want to take the... No, sir, that was a direct command from my dad. Are you with me? Son, carry the garbage out. And if I didn't get moving quickly, I had motivation from the backside to get up and get moving. Everybody know what I'm talking about? It's an imperative. It's a direct command. I want you to look at all the imperatives in Psalm 100 beginning at verse number 1. Now, stay with me. It's very important. Psalm 100 verse 1, first word of the verse, make. This is not a suggestion. This is a direct command. What are we to make? Look at the rest of the verse. Make a joyful, what's the word? A what? Joyful? Noise unto the Lord. Doesn't say sing beautiful. Our sister did that tonight. But if it said sing beautifully unto the Lord, can I let you know? I know two people in this room, a lot more, but I know of two that would be left out, and that's me and preacher, okay? Man, I can't sing beautifully, but I told you last night what I lack in talent, I make up for in volume. I do. I can make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Are you with me? Years ago, Pastor, first tent meeting I ever did. I never forget this. It was an interesting week. It was a revival meeting Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. It was a mission conference Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. I never seen that before nor since. But the pastor said, I want you to come, Dave. I want you to preach Sunday morning, Sunday night, Monday, Tuesday. I want your family to sing. He said, you can take the rest of the week off. You don't have any responsibilities to preach Wednesday through Saturday, but I'd love for your children to sing, your wife to play. I said, well, that's great. So Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, we had the revival. Boy, it was great. Wednesday night, we're under a big tent out on the church property. Wednesday night, two missionaries are going to share briefly. And between the two missionaries' presentations, Pastor, they had a lady sing. And it's just like it was yesterday. From behind the pulpit, the pastor said, now, sister, and he called the lady's name. She's going to come up and she's going to sing. And here's what I anticipated. I anticipated seeing someone just like you did. You had your music and you walked up front and you pulled it out from under the podium and you had a microphone and you sang. And I anticipated seeing that happen under that tent. That is not what happened. No, I knew we were in for something special when from about right here, under the tent, when he said, sister so-and-so is going to come sing, I heard a very distinct aluminum rattle of an aluminum wheelchair, and I turned and looked back, and this lady was pushing a wheelchair out into the aisle under the tent, out into the grass. I saw her open the wheelchair up. She pulled herself up. There's a person in the seat in front of her, and she pushed her crippled limbs out in front of the wheelchair, and when she got herself positioned, she let go and dropped into the wheelchair. She then grabbed the wheels, rolled herself all the way down the center aisle. Preacher, when she got right up here, she twisted the wheels like this and spun herself around. Man, she had done this a few times. She set the locks on the wheelchair. Nobody went to the piano or organ. There was no accompanist. There was no taped background. She just folded her arms in her lap and looked at all of us under the tent and did this. I'll never forget it. She just grinned from ear to ear. And then she started to sing a cappella. Preacher, I counted because I've grown up in a home of musicians. I don't mean she meant to do this. She did it unintentionally, but I counted. She changed pitch three times. I mean, she couldn't stay on pitch, but that was okay. Because all of a sudden behind me, and I'm on the front row, I begin to hear this. And I wanted to turn and look at who was crying. But it was too holy of an experience. But I began to hear more of it. That sister just kept singing. Do you know she knew nothing about music? But she had a relationship with the God of music. And she took what little talent she had and she lifted it and she made a joyful noise unto the Lord. Can I say this? With that, God was well pleased. It was awesome. Preacher, by the time she was done, and I don't say this often because it isn't true often, but it was true that night, there really wasn't a lot to say. She had modeled the truth by her joyful expression of praise to the Lord. And here in this room, and I'm not scolding you, I'm just saying it's the way it is. It's this way at our home church. We got people loaded down with talent, and they won't lift any of it in praise to the Lord. What gives here? The requirement is not sing beautifully, though many can do that. It just says make a joyful noise, and it's a command from God. Are you hearing me? Look at verse 2. Psalm 100, not only make a joyful noise, verse 2 goes on and says this, serve, not a suggestion, command. How are we to serve the Lord? Look at the rest of it. Serve the Lord with what? It doesn't mean serve the Lord with a scowl on your face. Is there a Walmart near here? I know there is. I saw it somewhere. Okay. Did they have a senior citizen at the front door of Walmart? Always. Anybody in here work at Walmart? Anybody? Okay. When you walk into the Walmart and the senior citizen at the front says, how you doing? You know what most people say? Fine. Get my shopping done. How you doing? Oh, okay. Why don't you try this? How you doing today? Better than I deserve. Amen. Amen. And if you do it right, they're going to ask you, well, what is it you deserve, sir? Tell them this. Well, I deserve to be in prison. I deserve to be in prison, but I really deserve after that to be in hell. Not you. Why would you deserve to be in prison or hell? Because I'm a murderer. Not you, sir. What are you doing out? Tell them this. The Bible says if you hate your brother without a cause, you've committed murder in your heart. Because that's what the Bible says. By the way, I'm not only a murderer, I'm an adulterer. If you look to lust, you've committed adultery in your heart. So I'm an adulterer. Oh, not you. Yes, me. But see, here's the awesome news. Here's why I'm doing better than I deserve. Though I deserve to be in prison and in hell, Jesus, the righteous one, died for me on an old rugged cross. He was buried, rose again the third day. I've asked Him to forgive my sin. He has. And so I'm not only not in prison, I'm not going to hell. I'm going to heaven forever. So I'm doing way better than I ever deserve. Amen. By the way, try that. They will never forget you at Walmart. I promise they will never forget you. What I'm getting at is this. Why don't we serve the Lord with a smile on our face? Are you with me? Pastor, one of my pastor friends told me this. Farmer in his church, driving his Ford pickup down a dirt road out to a field. His little boy, 11 years old, sitting in the passenger seat, looks past his daddy and says, "Daddy, look out there in the pasture. There's a great Christian." The dad looks as he's driving. He said, "Son, that's not a Christian. That's a mule." And the little boy says, "Well, Daddy, got to be a Christian mule. Look at the long face on that dude." Do you know having a long face is not a requirement to be a Christian? Can I hear an amen? Yes. What in the world is wrong with us? Look, do you know it's a win-win situation for us that are saved? Man, the worst that can happen to me, Brother Scott, is this, is to die and get entrance into heaven. That's the worst thing that can happen. That's a winning situation, isn't it? But if the Lord leaves me down here, I've got eternal life inside of me right now in the form of Jesus. I've got everything to be joyful about, so it's a win-win deal. Why in the world are we so somber? Some people look like an advance agent for an undertaker. My goodness. Smile, right? And serve the Lord with what? Gladness. Look at verse number four. I want you to watch this with your own eyes. Not only make a joyful noise, not only serve the Lord with gladness. Verse number four says, enter. By the way, that's not a suggestion, it's a command. How are we to enter into God's gates? Look at it. Enter into His gates with what? And into His courts with what? Praise. Folks, look at me for a minute. Do you know this was literally practiced by the Jewish people? It's always preacher called going up to the temple. Do you know they would carry with them the Hebrew hymn book, which was the book of Psalms, and as they went up to the temple to go into God's presence, they would sing the Psalms, which was their hymn book. They would literally go into God's presence by singing praises to His name. Do you know that's why we have songs before the preaching? Oh, is that just filler time, preacher? We've got to have something to fill. No, it's not filler. It's for a purpose. We're coming into God's presence. We ought to lift our voices in praise to our awesome Redeemer. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving and into His courts with praise. Look at the end of verse 4. Be thankful. That's not a suggestion. Be thankful. How are we to show our gratitude? Look at the rest of the verse. Be thankful unto Him by blessing. Literally, the word bless means praise. By praising His name. Look, do you get the idea that praise is a command? Now, here's why I'm stressing this. This is so important. Pastor, I have heard this I don't know how many times down through 32 years. Well, Brother Dave, I'm just not like you. I'm not demonstrative like you. By the way, my daughter got her degree from Regent University in drama, and I was preaching over in Virginia, and one of her classmates graduated with Hannah, came up to me after the service. She said, "Brother Kistler, now I know where Hannah gets it." I said, "What is it she's got that you think she got from me?" She said, "She's crazy, and you're crazier." She said, "But you do it with so much joy." I said, "Why not? I'm a child of the King. Are you with me?" Be thankful. Make. Serve. Enter. All these are commands. What I'm trying to get you to understand is this. Your personality is not the issue. So I've heard people say, "Well, I'm not like you, Brother Dave. I'm not demonstrative. I'm not as outgoing." Look, praising God has nothing to do with our personality. It is not a personality thing. It is an obedience thing. What God says we're to do, we do. So praise is a command. Amen. Watch this. Look at Psalm 9. Last time I'll have you turn there. Not only is praise a command, number two, praise is a conscious decision. Praise is a conscious decision. You say, preacher, where do you get that? Why do you say that? Look at Psalm 9. I want you to look what David says. This is so intriguing. Four times he's going to use a word. He's going to repeat it four times because he's trying to make a point. And by the way, I don't have time to go into this, but we were in Israel a year ago. We're going to be going back in April. And I saw the spot where David wrote a number of these psalms. And preacher, it was not a good situation for him. But look what he says in Psalm 9, verse 1. I will praise thee, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will show forth all thy marvelous works. Look at verse 2. I will be glad and rejoice in thee. Final time to put an exclamation point on it. I will sing praise to thy name, O thou most high. Ever get the idea that David's saying, look, I will do, God, what you've told me to do. Are you with me? You say praise you. It's a command. All right, I'm making a conscious decision to do it. See, most of us, folk, I'm one of you. I'm involved in this. I know my flesh is just like yours. Pastor, I think sometimes people think, you know, underneath, you know, below the white shirt and behind the red tie, or in Pastor's case tonight, that awesome paisley yellow tie, behind that paisley yellow tie, if he were to unbutton his shirt, there's a big S, super Christian. I want to see the S, okay? No. Fact of the matter is, preacher and I are made out of the same stuff you are. We get discouraged, or can. Do you know people that say things hurtfully actually can affect the preacher? I think they think we're like, who was the guy, Reeves, that was the first Superman? You know, they'd shoot bullets and boom, boom, they'd just bounce off. Man, I can level my criticism of the preacher. It just bounced. No. We're made of the same stuff you are. If it hurts your feelings, hurts ours. We're made out of the same flesh, but I want you to understand something. It has nothing to do with feelings. It has to do with obedience. So David said, you command me to praise you? I'll do it, Lord. Four times, I will. Praise you. Now, last time I want you to look back at Psalm 100. Principle of praise means to keep a running total of God's goodness. It's a command, it's a conscious decision. Number two, not only the principle of praise, number two, the purpose for praise. You say, Brother Dave, you're telling us to praise the Lord. Is there a reason? Sure is. Beyond just the fact that God says do it, He gives us two purposes for praising Him. Look at Psalm 100, verse 3. Know ye that the Lord, He is God. Folks, do you know why we ought to praise the Lord first and foremost? We ought to praise our Lord because He's God. By the way, read the book of Revelation. Brother Scott, we're going to spend the majority of time in the book of Revelation reveals, we're going to spend a great deal of time praising God just for who He is. Thou art worthy, Lord, to receive glory and honor and riches and strength. Lord, you're worthy just because of who you are. You're God. Now I want you to look at the rest of verse 3. I want you to see how He shows He's God. Know ye that the Lord, He is God. Well, how does He show that? Look at the next phrase. He shows He's God through creation. The verse says, it is He that hath made us and not we ourselves. Think about that. Praise the Lord. He's God. Here's how He shows He's God. He made you. You didn't make you. Now, folks, look up at me. I want to share something with you. Can I let you in on a little secret? If I had, Pastor, anything to do with making me, can I tell you I wouldn't look like this? Now, you're laughing. You know, that bothers me. That you're, I'm just kidding. Okay. Fact is, if I had anything to do with making me, I'd have shoulders about 5 feet wide. I'd have myself a 29-inch waist and never gain an inch. Perfect V. I'd have, you know what they sell all the products to get you, you know, the rock hard abs. I'd have muscles, preacher, in my fingers. And when people ask direction, I would turn my fingers this way and I would point as I flex the muscles in my fingers. You go that way. I'd never lose a hair. I wouldn't be wearing glasses. My hair would never turn gray, much less turn loose. If I had anything to do with making me, are you with me? But see, you're laughing because that's not how I look. Because I didn't make me. God did. Praise Him. Folks, have you noticed He made some of us shorter, others of us taller? He made some of us thinner, others of us with a propensity to maybe be a little heavier. He made some of us with blue eyes, others of us with green, hazel, brown eyes. He made some of us, you know, with a whole bunch of hair, others of us maybe not so much. By the way, I love that bumper sticker, preacher. I love it. I hadn't seen it in a while. Bumper of a car as I was driving along. I said, man, I'd love to have that. It said, God made a few perfect heads. The rest, He put hair on. That is good stuff. By the way, there's a few heads in here on their way to perfection, okay? I'm with you. Hey, look, we didn't make us, did we? Don't you wish the younger generation, the teenagers of America, the 20-something, don't you wish they understood this? God made you the way He made you for a reason, physically. Praise it. Because see, everybody's trying to look like somebody in Hollywood. And what they don't tell you is all those pictures of those Hollywood stars and starlets, they've been airbrushed. Because they ain't perfect either. Seen any of these things, you know, where they have the ladies, you know, without the makeup on? You ever seen that, brother? I was walking by, you know, Walmart. You know, they have them right there. And I saw this one lady and she didn't have makeup on. Oh, I mean, what is that? You know, that can't be who I thought that was. Yeah. Look, God made you the way He made you. Praise Him. Are you with me? Now, I'm not talking about attitudes. Preacher had a guy tell me one time. I said, man, why are you so angry? He said, that's the way God made me. I said, God never made that. No, sir. No. I'm not talking about attitudes here. I'm talking about physical traits. Okay, everybody with me? God made you physically the way He made you. Praise Him. By the way, ever thought about this? God allows to happen to you. What He allows to happen? Praise Him. We'll get personal here. Go to the doctor. He says, well, you know, we're going to have to run more tests, but we think this may be, and the dreaded C word comes up. I'll praise you, Lord, because you got a purpose. I don't understand it, Lord, don't have to, but I'll praise you. Are you with me? Lord takes one of your children like the Lord did with Betsy and me. Say, I don't have three, I have four. Got three here on earth, got one in heaven. To this day, I don't understand why God took that little one. But I don't have to understand because I know God's good. He not only made me, He allows to happen to me. What He allows to happen, praise Him. Why don't you look at verse 5? Psalm 100. Purpose for praise. Brother Dave, why should I praise the Lord? Because He's God. Not only is He God, He's also good. Look at verse 5. For the Lord is, would you say the word out loud? He is what? He is good. By the way, brother, there's nothing about our God but what the Scripture describes it as good. He's a good father. Do you know the Bible says, if ye as earthly dads know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more should your heavenly Father give good things to those that ask Him? He's a good father. Amen? Amen? He's a good friend. That proverb says, He's the friend that sticketh closer than a brother. And I got a twin brother. I know how close that can be. Jesus is a better friend than my twin brother ever dreamed of being. Amen? By the way, just let these guys know, there are times I wanted to kill my brother. I get so angry at him. But you know what? Nobody else had better lay a hand on him. Because, man, the two of us together, we could fight. We could. My brother and I can leave each other and not see each other for 7 months. We can end a conversation 7 months later, pick it up like it never never interrupted, no space in between. My brother's a good friend. Jesus is better. Nothing about him but what's good. Do you know the Bible says God has a good hand? He'll lay that good hand on anybody that'll serve him. By the way, if you read the books of Ezra and Nehemiah, this is the theme of both books because it's mentioned 8 times in those 2 books. According to the good hand of my God upon me. According to the good hand of my God upon me. Ezra and Nehemiah both keep saying that. According to the good hand of my God upon me. Do you understand? Those 2 men knew what it was to have God's good hand of blessing on them. And by the way, God will lay his good hand on anybody that'll serve him. Praise him. He's good. Nothing but good. All the time. By the way, I love the phrase, God is good, and all the time. That's not just a trite statement, that's the truth. Principle of praise, purpose for praise. I want you to turn to the book of Acts, chapter number 2. I want you to see one final thing tonight. We're going to be done and go home. Acts, chapter number 2. I want you to see the power of praise. The principle of praise means to keep a running total of God's goodness. It's a command, a conscious decision. Purpose for praise, we should praise the Lord because he's God, because he's good. But the power of praise. Wow. Acts chapter 2. I'm going to begin reading from that chapter in just a second. I want you to look up at me. I want to share something with you. Just 3 things. Do you know praise is so powerful that when we practice it, it will affect us 3 ways? The first of which is this, it will affect us physically. You say, preacher, what does that mean? I don't have time to turn and show you this. But do you remember there was a time when Israel went to fight their nemesis, the Philistines? And Pastor, you'll remember the story. Hophni and Phinehas, the 2 sons of Eli, the priest, kind of like Ford thought they had a better idea. Do you remember? And so they said, hey, Army of Israel, hey, leadership, you know what we need to do? We're going to face the Philistines. What we need to do is go bring the ark where God's Shekinah glory presence used to rest. And by the way, emphasis on used to rest at this time because Israel was so far away from God, God's Shekinah glory hadn't rested on that ark in a long time. At this point, it's nothing more than a piece of furniture. But we need to go get that sacred ark. We need to bring it down into the battle. It'll stir the troops up because we need stirring up to fight our nemesis. How many of you remember what I'm talking about? So, brother, they go bring the ark down there, and boy, it does. It initially has the desired effect. You know, they're shouting, man. And what the Philistines heard, though, across the valley that separated the Israelites from the Philistines, they heard a report that wasn't true. And what the Philistines heard, and it filtered among their army, Israel's God has come into the camp. That's what they heard. Folk, God hadn't gone anywhere. He wasn't on that box. Are you with me? That's what scares me out of my mind about America. We can still go through the motions and say, well, God, you got to bless it. God doesn't have to bless anything. Especially the way the church of Jesus has been living. No, it was a box. God hadn't gone into the camp to help them at all. But see, the Philistines think he has. So you know what they do? They fight harder than they've ever fought. And they defeat Israel. And the ark is captured. And Hophni and Phinehas are killed. And they carry the ark back to the Philistines' country. And they set it up in the temple of Dagon in front of their pagan deity. How many of you remember this? Wow. Remember the priests of Dagon leave after day number 1? They come in the next morning. Remember what old Dagon had done? He had bowed down to the ark of God. How many of you remember that? They got him propped back up and secured. Left at the end of the 2nd day. Came in the 3rd day. His arms and hands had fallen off. Do you remember that? I mean, old Dagon couldn't keep his act together, could he? And finally they say, man, we got to get this ark out of here. We're not going to have a deity left. Now I'm jumping over a lot of time here. But there comes a time when David, the king, says, we need to go down there and we need to bring the ark home. So they do. They make a brand new ox cart. And they go down and they retrieve the ark and they put that sacred box on an ox cart. Boy, that was problem number 1 right there, wasn't it? Because the Bible says it wasn't to be transported on an ox cart. It was to be carried. by the priests. In fact, they had rings on each end of the ark, and a long rod would go through there. Rings here and a long rod here. There'd be priests over there, priests here. They'd drape the ark with the appropriate coverings, and the priests would pick it up, and they would carry it. They put it on an ox cart. The ox cart's bouncing down the road. Evidently, one of the oxen tripped, because the Bible says one of the oxen stumbled. And a young man named Uzzah, the Bible says, put forth his hand to steady the ark, to stop it from sliding off the ox cart. And friends, forgive me, he touched the exposed, uncovered ark. Does anybody remember what happened to old Uzzah? God killed him. In fact, they named the spot Perez Uzzah. Perez means breach or bursting forth. They named the spot after what happened to Uzzah. This is the spot where God burst forth and killed Uzzah. Scared Israel to death, and rightly so. They turned the ox cart aside, take it down a little side road to the house of a gentleman named Obed-Edom. The ark stays in Obed-Edom's house for 3 months. And boy, Obed-Edom treated the ark with respect, and God blessed the house of Obed-Edom. Preacher, long and short of it is this. They read up on how they're supposed to transport it, not on an ox cart, priests. They go down, they drape the ark with the appropriate coverings. Priests over there, priests here, pick it up. They carry it in procession and enter the city. And David, who's king at the time, is in the procession. Preacher, I love this. As they enter the city, David is behind the ark, leaping. And stay with me. Don't throw a hymn book. The Bible says he's dancing. Am I speaking truth, Scott? Which doesn't mean, you know, he's getting down. You know what I'm saying? No. No. Ouch. By the way, that hurt. Too old to do that. The word dancing doesn't mean getting down. It literally means spinning or whirling. He's leaping and spinning. Leaping and spinning, here's the third word, and praising God. Do you understand his praise affected him physically? He was a little excited. Are you with me? The ark's coming home. Now, I know what you're thinking. Brother Dave, if I did that in church, somebody would misunderstand. Probably. Let me tell you why they probably would. Because somebody misunderstood David. Remember Michael, his wife, Saul's daughter? She saw the king out the window of their apartment, leaping and spinning and praising God. And he comes up the step and into the apartment. And she put her hands, no doubt, on her hips, and she said, and this is a direct quote, "How glorious today was the king of Israel in the sight of all the maidens of Israel." You say, what does that mean? It means this, buddy, you made a spectacle out of yourself today. You embarrassed me. You know what David said? I love this. I wasn't doing it for you. Here's the way he said it, though. He said, it was before the Lord. I wasn't doing it for you. I was doing it for my Lord. Are you with me? That's why I say it doesn't matter what anybody else thinks about our singing. Only if he's pleased. Are you with me? Praise will affect you physically. Ought to cause you at least curl the corners of your mouth up a little bit. By the way, can we do this? Just a simple exercise tonight. Index and second finger like this. You're not volunteering for anything, okay? Turn them around this way. Take your fingers now, put them in the corners of your mouth. Take your other hand, put it on your elbow, and push up. That's called a revival push-up, by the way. Maintain the expression. You can take your hand down. We ought to smile a little bit. Are you with me? Every once in a while, we might want to say, well, amen. Yeah, that didn't hurt at all, did it? Or how about, well, glory, every once in a while. I was in a church preacher and a guy did that. Just like that. Well, glory. You know what everybody did? Turned. Where'd that come from? I mean, they were shocked. Hadn't heard an amen or a well, glory in so long. Hey, we can go to a ball game and jump up and down, yell and scream, right? We're a fan. But if we say amen in church, we're a fanatic, right? Something wrong about this. Something wrong. By the way, I decided years ago, if I could give 110% on the athletic field, I could give 110% serving my King. Are you with me? So I'm going to be a little excited. And by the way, you can choose not to be, but don't you burst my bubble. Are you with me? God's been good. Praise will affect us physically. Number two, hope you'll write this down. Praise is so powerful that number two, it will affect us emotionally. Oh, Brother Dave, what does that mean? Oh, I wish I had time to turn and I don't. Let me just quote it. James 5. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. You know what psalms are? They're songs of praise to the Lord. Is any among you afflicted? Wow, preacher, I'd love to camp out there. Any among you depressed? Down? Any of you struggling with what's going on in your life or in the world? You know, there's a two-part prescription. Let him pray. Let him praise. Oh, I wish I had time to go into this, and I don't. But I'll tell you this much. My daddy was never a depressed kind of guy. My dad was as funny as a rubber crutch. He was absolutely hysterical. He never met a stranger. I mean, you would laugh till you hurt around my dad. Funny. My grandfather was the same way. What was that, brother? You just got that, didn't you? I love it. I love it. By the way, those guys up there never get much credit. Probably they're doing an awesome job. Thank you, fellas. I appreciate it so much. Yeah, my dad was never a down kind of guy. But he got depressed in 1991. Things going on in the church, and he had a teacher he respected in his Bible college days, and that teacher was still alive. We drove my dad down to the college in South Carolina where he graduated, went into Dr. Walter G. Fremont's office. Dr. Fremont was one of these guys. He'd be teaching a class, have his suit on, and then he'd get excited about something, and he would literally do this. I saw him do that so many times. He'd pull his lapel up like this and tuck his mouth into his lapel and yell, "Glory!" like that. I mean, just real. He was an amazing man. Brilliant. PhD. Earned PhD. We took my dad in there, and my dad said, "You know, Doc, I'm discouraged, and here's what's going on at the church," and he went through everything. When he got done, Dr. Fremont, I'm sitting there with my dad, and Dr. Fremont said, "Okay, preacher," he said, "I want to give you a two-part prescription." I got my pad out. I was going to write it down. Thought it was going to be something we're going to have to go get at the pharmacy. And so I'm ready to write that down. He said, Oh, Dave, no, you won't have to write it down. He said, "You're not going to have to go get it anywhere." He said, "You're going to get it right here, and it's going to be easy to remember." I said, "Okay." He said to my dad, "Preacher Kistler, if you're discouraged, do two things, and you won't feel like doing either one of them. But since when have we lived by our feelings?" And then he said this, "We don't feel ourselves into new actions. We act ourselves into new feelings." That's a powerful statement. We don't feel ourselves into new actions. By the way, you know a lot of couples are trying to feel themselves into new actions? "Well, I don't feel like I love you anymore. And until I feel that, I guess I'm going to leave." No, we don't feel ourselves into new actions. We act ourselves into new feelings. Are you with me? We just keep serving our spouse and loving them and doing the things that we're supposed to do. I'll tell you this, I've been married 31 years. It's sweeter now than the day we got married. It is. And she has to be something to stay around this guy. I mean, she does. One of these days y'all are going to meet her. She's sweet. She is. She's awesome. Here's a two-part prescription, Brother Kistler. You're not going to feel like doing either one of them, but do it anyway. Pray and praise. Pray and praise. When you're discouraged, pray and praise. Pray and praise. Pray. You know, he said that, I don't know how many times. Pray and praise, and he didn't mention Prozac one time. Not one time. "Preacher, are you telling me to get off my meds?" No, that's not what I'm telling you. I'm just telling you Dr. Fremont didn't mention Prozac. He said, if you're discouraged, pray and praise. We walked out of his office. My dad said, "Boy, that's pretty simple, wasn't it?" I said, "Well, yes, sir. Pretty simple." I said, "I guess the key is the implementation." Dad said, "Yeah, I got to practice what I've been preaching, don't I?" I said, "Yes, sir. But you can do it. You know, he didn't feel like doing it. He started praying and praising like he'd never done before. You know what God did? He lifted my daddy out of his depression. It works, folks. I'm telling you. It works. Praise will affect us emotionally. Here's the point I want to get to, and I'm done. Praise is so powerful. I'm talking about the power of praise. When we practice it, it affects us physically. We'll smile. We'll be joyful. It'll affect us emotionally. Number three, this is the big one. It'll affect us spiritually. Now, folks, what I'm about to show you can be personally life-changing. It can be corporately church life-changing. Look at Acts 2:41. Now, stay with me. It's very important. Then they that gladly received his word, and the his here happens to be Peter. Peter's the one preaching. He's preaching God's word, but Peter's the one preaching. This is the day of Pentecost. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. How would you at Daniel's Missionary Baptist Church like to have the responsibility of discipling 3,000 new converts? Wouldn't that be awesome? What'd they do with them? Look at verse 42. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. That's the preaching and teaching ministry of the church. That's what we're doing right here. And in fellowship. That's what we did. Brother Scott, yesterday afternoon around the table, we had fellowship. It was awesome. It was sweet. It's what Pastor and I did and his dear wife tonight around the dinner table. Fellowship. Look at the rest of it. And in breaking of bread and in prayers. And fear, verse 43, came upon every soul. Many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. And all that believed were together and had all things common, sold their possessions and goods, parted them to all men according as every man had need. Now watch verse 46. And they continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house did eat their meat. Literally, they ate their meals or they ate their food with what? How did they eat every meal? They ate it with what? Gladness. Watch this. And singleness of heart. Look at the first word of verse 47. Praising God. What's the result? And having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be, what's the last word? Saved. Now this is your homework assignment. You can do it later tonight. Read through the book of Acts. From Acts 2 on. Brother, every time any individual in the church or the church collectively praised God, the end result is somebody got saved. Every time without exception. Remember the lame man at the beautiful gate, rattling his little cup, alms, alms. Peter and John walk by and say, silver and gold we don't have any of. What we do have, we'll give you. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. Do you remember? And the man got up and he's jumping and praising God and he goes into the temple. And if you follow the story all the way through, 5,000 people get saved. Acts 16, and I'm just hopscotching through the book of Acts. Midnight, Paul and Silas in a jail at Philippi prayed and sang praises to God. Listen to this. And the prisoners heard them. Along comes an earthquake. Rattles the jail doors open. Remember the old jailer? Preacher, Roman law said if you lose one prisoner, you pay with your life. He thinks all of them are going to escape. So he just draws his own sword out, turns the point toward his abdomen, grabs the handle, going to run himself through. He's going to save the torture process because he's about to lose everybody, he thinks. Paul sees him getting ready to do that and says, sir, do yourself no harm. Don't hurt yourself. We're all here. Do you remember? And the old jailer, Bible doesn't say he sauntered, strolled into the jail cell where Paul and Silas were. The Bible says he sprang into the jail cell. He jumped in there and said, sirs, tell me what I got to do to be. Isn't that interesting? Oh, preacher, I know why he wanted to get saved. Earthquake scared him into it. No, what he had witnessed that night was this. Two guys in the wrong circumstance, stocks and bonds. Two guys at the wrong time of night, midnight. Two guys in the wrong situation, backs laid open. They had no reason to be doing this. They were doing it anyway. They were praising God. And he said, man, I got to have what you guys got. Tell me what I got to do to be saved. They told him. He got saved that night in his entire house. Do you remember? Wow. Listen to Psalm 40, verse 1. I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined his ear unto me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of an horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my goings. And he hath put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. Many shall see it and shall fear, listen to this, and shall trust in the Lord.
when they see and hear my song of praise, they'll trust in my God. Wow.
Folks, I'm telling you, I am convinced the reason we're not seeing more people saved is because more of God's people aren't praising like they should. Now I'm going to close with this, preacher. It was 1992. Little church, suburbs of Hickory, North Carolina, called Southside Baptist Church. No kidding, the entire church building, auditorium, was from here to here, from here to the back. Just these two sections of seats. That was the entire size of the auditorium. We had on Thursday night 110 people in that space. You know what? I was scared to death because they had a middle aisle, no outside aisles. I mean, the pews went right to the wall. I was scared to death. Everybody happens accidentally to inhale at the same time, the walls are going to go out. I mean, it was jam-packed. The service, I don't know, was maybe, I don't know, halfway done. Through the back doors walked five guys. Big old boy, big old boy. He was the guy that brought all the others. Him and four other thinner guys. No place to sit, so they stood along the back wall. Brother Scott, something happened that evening that up until that time, I was young in the ministry. I'd never seen this happen before. But a lady felt prompted of God to say something. She raised her hand right over here where you are, ma'am. Pardon me for pointing. She raised her hand. I said, "Yes, ma'am." She said, "Could I share something, preacher?" I said, "Sure." So she stood up. She just started weeping, and she said, "I want to praise God for something. See, I've been listening tonight and talking about how good God is to us, and Brother Dave's been talking about that, and I don't even remember now what I was preaching on, but she said he's been talking about how good God is, and she said, I just want to tell you what God saved me from." And boy, she went into her testimony. She had been a wicked lady, but God had turned her life around. And she said, "I just want to praise him." She sat down right over here. A man said, "Preacher, can I follow up on that?" I said, "Well, sure." I didn't know it, but boy, he'd been a pretty profligate guy too. He said, "But God changed my life, saved my soul. He's given me back the things the devil took from me." You know, the Bible teaches a principle that God will restore the years that the locusts have eaten. The devil's the one that consumes your life, makes it go bad. You know what Jesus will do? He'll do you good all the days of your life, not evil. He'll restore. And that man said, "God's restored everything back to me." He said, "I just want to praise him." Preacher, from there, it was like popcorn. People standing up, everybody, saying, can I share? And it just kind of started. Those guys along the back heard every bit of that. Well, it went on for a little while. Finally, it came to an end, and I said, "Well, folk, let's do this. We didn't expect this, but would you bow your heads?" They did. I said, "I want to ask a question. Because people have been praising God for the day they were saved, talking about what Jesus has done to transform their life." I said, "It's possible in this room there's some people that don't understand what they've been talking about. You don't have that joy. So I'm curious, if you're not sure that you've ever been forgiven and saved, but you'd like to know something about what you've heard, I wonder if you'd lift your hand." Scott, as I'm standing here along the back wall, five hands, big guy and the other four, all hands went up. I thought they misunderstood me. So I backed up and repeated it. You know, "Well, okay, let me go through this again. You know, great man of faith I was, you know." I said the same thing, "You know, if you're not sure you're going to heaven, but you've heard people testify about what Jesus can do and you'd like to know something about that, I wonder if you'd lift your hand." All five hands went up again. I thought, well, they understand. So I said this. I said, "No, look, here's the deal. Everybody's got their head bowed. If you lifted your hand and you would really like to know about how you can have the joy and peace these folk have, it's through Jesus Christ, by the way. He is our joy. He is our peace. He is our way. He is our truth. He is our life. Are you with me? If you'd like to know him, I'm going to invite you to do something in this crowded little room. I'm going to invite you to come down that thin middle aisle." Preacher, it was hilarious in one sense. The big guy stepped out into the aisle. He looked back at the other four. He snapped his finger. It sounded like a gunshot. And he got their attention. He said, "So here they all came." You know, every one of those boys got saved.
Preacher, how do you know? Because they were back the next night. That's a good sign, isn't it? And you know what? They were back, and all five of them, you know, they'd gone home. And let's tell you how long ago it was, 91, 92. They went and emptied out their cars in their rooms of all their rock music cassettes, put them in big paper bags, grocery bags, and brought them to the service. They met me in the parking lot when I arrived and said, hey, the big guy said, preacher, listen, can we do this tonight? Can we burn all this stuff up? I said, well, you know, it's interesting. The Bible says in Acts 19, they burned the books of the curious arts, even totaled up the price. It was 50,000 pieces of silver. So, yeah, I guess we could do that. I said, let me ask the preacher. So I ran to the pastor. I said, pastor, is there anywhere a big barrel or something, you know, like a big 55-gallon drum? He said, yes, we have one that we use as a garbage can. I said, can we use that? Because these guys have got all these rock music cassettes. They want to burn them up after the service. He said, that's awesome. Yes. So at the end of the service, I said, our five guests that were here last night, they're back. There was a chorus of amens. I said, they've brought something with them. They want us to rejoice with them. And after the service, if you can stay, and boy, not a person left, we're going to dump all that stuff they brought into a big 55-gallon drum. We're going to throw some lighter fluid on it. We're going to throw a match. We're going to stand around and watch that stuff burn up, and we're going to sing Amazing Grace. And we did all the above. Preacher, it was awesome. Those boys were tossing cassettes in there. I mean, having fun. Singing Amazing Grace. How sweet. Ding! It was incredible. Now, stay with me. Do you know the night before, they heard very little of my sermon? What they did hear were the praises of God's people and very clear testimonies of what Jesus had done in their heart. And the big guy told me this. He said, Dave, he said, I've never had that kind of peace. By the way, brother, he drove a little yellow VW Beetle. There were five guys in a little VW Beetle. They had to unwrap themselves to get out of that. He said, I have never had that kind of joy. And if they've got that, I want it. And they got saved. Folk, listen to me. People are watching you, and they're watching me. Are we praising people? Father, would you speak to us tonight? And Lord, may we not just have listened, though folks have listened phenomenally well. May we not just have learned something. Though I trust we have learned, Lord, may we actually live. May we live tonight that which we have listened to. And then, Lord, I would pray if there's any person in this room that does not yet know for sure that Jesus, you are their Savior. If they've never come to you and admitted, I'm a sinner, and I'm sorry for my sin, and Jesus, I put my faith and trust in you alone to forgive my sin, because Jesus, you're the only one that can do that. If there are young people or adults that are not sure they're going to heaven, not sure they've ever really been forgiven and saved, Father, I pray that like those five guys in that little church outside Hickory in 92, Father, I pray that folks would come to you tonight before it's too late. Now, friends, with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, I want to ask you a couple of questions.